Welcome to this special show. My name is Vineet Malhotra, and this is a joint program with Business World, and it's an endeavor to get the best voices from the world of business directly to you. Well, the economy is staring down the barrel. Unemployment is rampant, and the world is going through an unprecedented phase. Everything is affected, right? From schools to the economy, to the government, to businesses, you name it, and it has been affected by COVID-19. But what really matters during this pandemic and what really needs some sort of a revival for survival is the economy. And the government has taken some steps. Are those steps in the right direction? Are those steps going to rejuvenate, re-galvanize the economy as was projected when this year started? Well, we really don't know. That's why we have some of the best business minds on the show right now. And let me introduce them in no particular order. Mr. Aditya Gadge, founder and CEO of AIWMI. Let me also welcome Mr. Adarsh Manpuria, co-founder of Fab Hotels. I have with me Mr. Ankit Prasad as well, founder and CEO of Bobble. I hope I pronounced that right. Mr. Akshay Gulati, CBO and co-founder of ShipRocket. Ms. Mrinal Sharma, co-founder of Baba's Beans. And last, but by no means the least, my co-anchor, my partner in crime during this next hour, Mr. Anurag, Dr. Anurag Bhadra, I beg your pardon, chairman and editor-in-chief, Business World and Exchange for Media Group. Aditya, if you can hear me, I'll come to you first.
Sure.
Right, Aditya, as you know, by my opening monologue, I want to know from you whether you think that the government has taken right steps to revive the economy. Obviously, firstly, let's remember that there was a lot of criticism towards the government that it got delayed. The stimulus package was delayed. And then when it came about, it was not efficacious. There were too many middlemen involved. There are too many delays. And it was only focusing on MSMEs. There were a lot of areas like real estate and restaurants, which were not at all even touched upon by Nirmala Sitharaman. What has your assessment been so far?
All right. So my assessment is government is, okay. It's not a full and final stuff that government has come out with. I think it's more about holding on. You know, we are into a very unprecedented situation. We do not know which side the tide will turn, how long it's going to continue, when we're going to be back to normal. So I think the focus is more about ensuring that the things keep going on in this period. It's not exactly a stimulus package to kickstart everything back. So if you look at it, we talk about that 20 lakh thousand crore kind of a thing, but yeah, out of this, hello.
Yeah, Aditya, I can't see you and I can just hear you. Why don't you try and fix your video in the meantime? Let me go to Adarsh, try and fix your video. We'll also try something at our end and we'll come back to you momentarily.
Sure.
Adarsh, the same question coming to you. Are you satisfied with what the government has done? And, you know, these are unprecedented times. These are scary times, horrific times for a lot of businesses. I was speaking to a friend of mine who is an expert in the restaurant business. He said that most of the restaurants, 60% of them, will shut down by the end of this year. And the ones that will survive, I'm just giving you an example, and the ones that will survive will also be surviving on a very thin leash.
Yes, absolutely, Vineet. You know, I think you make a very valid point. I think the overall economy is struggling quite a bit right now. We're just in unlock one. I think what is important to remember is that, as the government itself has called it, we are still in unlock one, and a lot needs to be desired. A lot is desired to be done still, right? So I think with the kind of case count that is increasing and the kind of restrictions that are still in place, I definitely don't think that we have done all that it is going to take to bring the economy back to normal or back to pre-COVID levels. You know, we ourselves at Fab Hotels, we are part of the travel and tourism industry, and we are first in the firing line. If you talk about the hospitality industry in general, which includes both hotels and restaurants, they are first in the firing line when you will have any kind of pandemic or this kind of a lockdown. And not just for restaurants, but even for hotels. You know, the hospitality sector in India employs around 10 to 15% of the workforce. This number runs into the crores. And there's massive unemployment. demand, as you were asking me, I think just unlocking is not going to be enough. There is a long, long journey that we have to make in terms of restoring traveler confidence to go get back onto flights, to start going into hotels. So really unlocking is just phase one. It's actually phase 0.1, not even phase one. And there is so much more together that not just the private stakeholders, but the government and the tourism ministries and the restaurant regulators and everybody will have to come together and repose the consumer faith before you can find guests again in restaurants or in hotels for that matter.
No, Adarsh, just to build on this, you are in a double negative spot. One, you're a startup who's always raising capital. Second, you're in the hospitality sector. So my larger question to build on Vineet's question is, do you see that startups whose revenues have gone down to zero or close to zero, and they haven't been able to raise funding, do you see a lot of startups not being there 60 to 90 days from now? And if yes, how can the government make sure that these startups are sustained?
Yes, I think good question. And I would say that, it will be unfair to shift the burden entirely on the government here. I think just by virtue of being startups, we are in a make-believe business environment at all times. And I think whether you're a startup or you're a mid-sized company, an SME, or a large enterprise, if you are standing still right now, then you will get left behind. So you definitely have to figure out new demand channels, new pivots to get new travelers, new guests, new clients at all time, at all points of time, even to keep standing. And then if you want to race ahead or survive or become sustainable, you really will have to find new ways of doing that. What you were doing in January or February of 2020 is definitely not going to be enough. So I can give you some examples of what we are doing at Fab Hotels, right? So typically, our guests at Fab Hotels either are retail travelers or corporate travelers where we have tie-ups with companies or travel agents. However, the coronavirus pandemic has forced us, and we have taken the initiative to figure out new lines of demand, whether it is our Work from Fab Hotels initiative for large corporates who are struggling to open their offices with 100% capacity, or it is our 100% Safe Place to Stay initiative for the general online traveler, who needs some assurity before he can get on the flight and get into a hotel that what will be the hygiene measures that will be taken? What will be the sanitization measures? Whether the staff will be trained or not? How will you be washing the linen? How will you be preparing the food? So whether really I can feel secure whether I have to go into a hotel or not, right? We have partnered with the government's Vande Bharat mission. So we really will have to go above and beyond to find silver linings in this, thunderous times that we are living in. And definitely you cannot stand still and hope to be where you were before the pandemic.
All right, Ankit, let me come to you now. Finding a silver lining, figuring out that there is a positive in this negative atmosphere as well. And very important point made there by others that you cannot afford to stand still. But is there an option not to stand still when everything around you is locked down, when everything, there is no demand, there is no liquidity, and there is no sentiment?
Okay, Vineet, that's a good question, but depends which perspective you're looking at it from. From our perspective, which is a pure digital and techno.
From a consumer's perspective, from a customer's perspective, there is no galvanization in me to buy anything right now
because demand is down. What Vineet is saying, demand is down, sentiment is down. Even if you have money as a consumer, you are only investing in where it's needed.
Yes, definitely. It might have impacted some of the industries severely, but there are certain industries which falls in the silver line, and we are anticipating a much higher growth and much higher change in user behavior in the times to come. We have seen, for example, temporarily the advertisement dollars have also dropped significantly. Earlier, what used to be, say, 0.8 or $1 CPM has now gone down to 0.1 or $0.15 CPM, which is sad for the industry. But having said that, we are anticipating a much higher budget being allocated by industries for online advertisement and digital channels and digitalization of their services and processes, which would which would definitely help a lot of peers who are working in the digital and tech industry to boom in the coming times. But having said that, yes, the government has taken at least initiated some of the good steps. But still, there is a, you know, we still need to realize the benefits out of those policies. I think the very first thing that the government should have done or must have done until now is at least follow their existing policies to its best capacity. For example, GST refunds and income tax refunds, which were supposed to be given back to us, which
but
is our
okay, just I'm interrupting you. You know, one of my companies had an income tax refund. It came back 4 weeks back. So the government has started to, I'm talking about the government has started to front load it. The government is executing. The government is doing its best. Can it do better? Maybe yes. But the government has started to give those tax refunds.
Yes, we in fact, even us got 30 or 20% of our GST refund last week itself. And that was after too much of, you know, networking and sending messages and communication from various channels to the right stakeholders. After 2 years, we got this refund, which is just 20% of our actual 100% refund.
So we are here. Ankit, you are saying the government should just give its payments. If the government can bring the circulation back, the economy will get up. We've come back to you. Akshay, you heard Adarsh, you heard Ankit, and you briefly heard Aditya. What is your response to the economic stimulus? Luckily, you're in a sweet spot where your company and your sector seems to be blossoming. So tell us, what's your outlook on the economy?
Absolutely, and thank you for having me here today. I think overall, we're actually pretty happy with what the government has done over the last 2 months or so, especially with the economic stimulus in terms of lending and front-loading a lot of capital out for MSMEs. MSMEs are the bulk of our business. Over 70% of the people we deal with are in this sector. And I think, again, the wish list can be very, very high, right? I can put 1,000 other things that they did not do. But we have to keep in mind that there is only that much wiggle room that this government had going into this pandemic. I think the fact that, yes, it may have come late, but it has come. You talk about the income tax refunds, etc. Again, stories like that are plenty abound where people are getting that capital now into their system. I think from an economic stimulus perspective, they've done enough. On the demand side, so far, the government hasn't really come out with any stimulus. And hopefully that is something that will come in the coming months. I think they've tried to just fix the structural issues right now. And the only thing that I think that the government really needs to take seriously now is getting the economy working again. It's not just the money you put in somebody's pockets. There's no point giving an SME a loan of 2 lakh rupees when he doesn't actually have, for example, the labor to run his business, because all the migrant labor has gone back to their villages. And with our clients, like, we survey them every month to try and see how we can work with them better and support them better. The one complaint we keep on getting about people who are not able to get back on their feet after even in Unlock 1.0 is saying that, how do I get my warehouse open again when I don't have people to actually operate the warehouse? So what's the point of putting the lights on? Because there's no one to actually do the work. And I think there, a much more structured and measured response on the actual fundamental side from the government would be very, very helpful. Because they've given these loans that MSMEs can take, they've given a moratorium on interest. And I think all of those things will help, but they'll only help. You have to pay back the loan. If I can't get my business up and running again today, how do I pay back the loan even 6 months from now? And I think that's where we're hoping.
Here to Akshay, what you're saying, the government has to try and deal with the fear that people that live in the cities or the immigrant labor has. Once that fear factor goes away from the mind of people and they try to some kind of a normal, not really normal, but they get back to some percentage of normal, things will automatically flow back. At this point,
the consumption side as well.
Yes, actually.
Sorry, I was just saying, and that will then flow into the consumption side as well, right? So you'll start seeing people spending more because they're earning again. And that cycle, then having a demand stimulus from the government will probably help a lot more than it will help right now.
Sure. What is heartening to hear from all entrepreneurs, including Ankit and others, and you, Akshay, is that government has done the most it could have. Entrepreneurs should do more, and we are capable of doing more. Just give us that environment where people feel safe. We'll go back and build our businesses. Mrinal, yours is a B2B business and a retailing business. And the retailing side, though, only 2 outlets have been, you know, retailing has almost come to zero. So how are you dealing with it? Where do you see the economy going? And what is your response to what the government has done?
Okay, so I think as Fab Hotels and other hotels and restaurants in the industry were also badly hit. But as a coffee shop, we're greatly banking upon the takeaways and, of course, home deliveries. And we even do home orders for powder, coffee powder, home brewing. So that is still running. But as far as the as we were talking about the environment, as mentioned before, that just giving out money in the banks and hands of people is not is not the only thing that the government can do. When we talk about creating a healthy environment for the economy to survive, I think we need to focus on reforms and policies more rather than just spending money and giving out funds. Like, for example, even in the restaurant industry, waiving off licensing fees where the restaurant wasn't running would be really helpful. Then even for deliveries, like, we pay exorbitant amount of tax on every cup of coffee that we sell. Maybe when we know that there is no dining and we are only banking on takeaways, the taxes can go down on every cup that sell. That not only helps us in selling, but also affects the consumer directly and increases the demand. So similarly, I mean, even going back to the B2B part, as you mentioned, right now, I mean, the government has to come up with the policies which are short run, like waiving off taxes or reducing taxes. And in the long run, we can look at which would actually revive the economy. In the long run would be reforms, where they have actually done a lot in terms of taking out a great fund for the agriculture sector. But again, as said before, this just taking out a fund won't be enough. It would be about creating policies and reforms that makes the environment healthy. And when I'm talking about from the B2B point of view and the agricultural point of view, like, for example, recently they increased the import duties on bamboo sticks, and that from 10% to 25%. That really helped the agarbatti industry to boom right now and create opportunities and job employment for many of inlands. Similarly, when we're talking about the agriculture sector, and especially the economy or the farmers being put on a global platform where it's open to them, it's very important that the government comes up with strong reforms and policies that protects the domestic market. For example, coming from a coffee industry, I know in 91, the farmers were open to sell it to anyone, their coffees. But why the domestic market boomed in terms of coffee in India is because we have 100% import duty on coffee. Similar reforms and policies would really help in creating a healthy environment if we look at reviving the economy in the long term.
Now, I agree with everything you said. The only thing I don't agree with is I don't think import duties are the way. We have to get our game up. We have to be competitive. And, you know, for a limited window, there can be import duties. I don't think we can be Anurag to any country. But anyway, that's my comment.
Aditya is back with us, Anurag. In fact, yeah. We couldn't hear for him. We couldn't get his initial reactions. Aditya, we can see you now. We can hear you now as well. If you remember my question.
Yeah. Anurag, especially I'll add to what Vineet said to you. Financial services, the sector, is a sector that can provide oxygen to everyone, so to say. So you come from that financial services sector. Tell us, what can the government do specifically to get that financial services sector going?
No, so as I was mentioning in the beginning, I think what government has done is just to, you know, it's more of an interim thing to keep us going. It's not exactly a final stimulus. I think, as I say in Hindi, picture to be baki hai, and I think that should happen only once the situation is clear. I think we're in the middle of nowhere. And financial education is, you know, equally as affected as everyone else. What government should do, I think, if you look at financial sector, yes, providing oxygen, but where is it lacking? After so many years of privatization, we're talking about mutual fund folios just being around 2.5 crores in India. We're talking about insurance policies just being about 30-odd crores. On a financial inclusion basis, we are one of the most least penetrated countries. And I think there has to be a much major initial effort towards this long back. We're talking about Jan Dhan banks, which came into existence in the, you know, a few years ago. And look at how handy, you know, they came to be proved. So I believe there's a lot of work that government needs to do. One, on to ensure that financial inclusion takes up pace, so more and more people can be brought under this umbrella of different services. And two is create a very skilled pool of financial service professionals. So I am from the financial education sector, and you know, the reason I've been here, you know, I chose this is because financial literacy, we believe, was always missing, not only in the investors but also among the professionals. Now we're slowly getting there, where you know, some companies have started doing, you know, taking in initiatives and efforts to ensure that the people are the people who are their representatives are properly trained. But I think we have a long way to go. And a case in point here is, again, I mean, if I had to talk about, let's say, advisors, one of the major component in the entire financial services ecosystem. Just look at the advisor, financial advisor community in the last few years. They have been battered. I mean, not at their fault. I mean, I'm all for SEBI's proactive measures in bringing down costs and, you know, creating more regulations, everything. But does this guy have enough time to change their ways? I don't think so. Did anyone work, you know, on specifically on enhanced preparing advisors for the next level of normal? No. So they are caught napping, and this is a very, very important community, which because Indian investors are financially illiterate, and unless and until the intermediaries are properly trained and given that breathing space and given a business which they can run for, you know, for their career, this problem will not be solved. We have too many fly-by-night operators in the sector, which is basically affecting everyone. Talking about banks, Indian banks were already in a big pit much before the lockdown happened, thanks to our NPAs and, you know, the bad ratios. And we are now one of the highest in the world. And I think a lot of work needs to be done there on the credit education side and on the on bringing certain strict measures when it comes to lending and all. So financial services, yes, it is enough oxygen, but I think there are a lot of other ills which are plaguing it right now. And they have nothing to do with lockdown. This is a good wake-up call, though. I believe if we, industry and regulators, and especially the government, can look into it from a slightly long-term perspective, there's so much more that can be done to strengthen this particular sector.
Thank you so much. You know, I just want to go back to Ankit. Ankit, since you're in the artificial intelligence space, the technology space, and technology in some way holds the key to India's growth of GDP. Tell us, is it a realistic dream to expect technology to help us kind of leapfrog in terms of GDP, or it is just a survival thing?
Yes, thank you so much for asking this question. I always believe that India has been leading the world when it comes to technology. At least Indians have been leading the world when it comes to technology. And I believe...
True statement, yeah.
Yeah. If not India, at least Indians have been leading the world. And if Chinese are good at manufacturing goods, we are good at manufacturing technology and softwares. And I think this is the high time we leverage it.
And we still don't have a single product company from India. We haven't brought a Microsoft.
You must have already read about Postman, I believe. Postman's API.
Right. So maybe one. And that we'll see to what level it scales up. But, you know, I'm talking the scale of a Microsoft. I'm talking the scale of other product companies.
Yes.
We still don't have a single product company from India.
Yes, true that. But we still have many companies who outsource manpower in the technology domain, be it Wipro, TCS, and Infosys, and Tech Mahindra, and whatnot. All of them are still leveraging the Indian technology strength, but in a different manner. Instead of creating product, they're creating services out of it, which is another way of looking at things. While we have the technological mindset, now we need to leverage this and understand the change in consumer behavior. The consumer behavior change that we have seen during the lockdown is not going to evaporate suddenly. A certain portion of it is going to remain there with time, right? And we need to empower our SMEs and startups. Startups are, you know, already thinking for the future world, but at least we need to empower the SMEs to start thinking of digitization, to start thinking of leveraging technology for themselves. And government could probably do a lot more than we're doing it right now. Startup India initiative is great initiative. Can a similar initiative be created for SMEs where they can be upgraded to the next level?
But I think the focus of the stimulus package, Ankit, was specifically more so. In fact, the government was also criticized for that, was predominantly MSMEs.
Yes, but you know, if you look at the package, it is more sort of providing more liquidity to the SMEs or getting access to the loan and credit. Even then, there are certain terms and conditions in the blueprint which is hard for everyone and the larger percentage of SMEs to satisfy. For example, you can avail loan if you are profitable, and you can avail loan if you already have a credit line in place with some of the banks, and you can take only 10% extra on that existing credit line. There are, you know, restrictions, and there are terms and conditions which kind of restricts the total benefit that they can get. But apart from money, I believe what is more important, I think somebody from the panelists also mentioned, can we educate or can we invest in creating awareness and education among the SME owners and how they can leverage the technology in making their services, in upgrading their services and taking it to the new consumers who have a very different set of expectations now. Now, the SMEs have to meet those expectations if they want to continue the demand, if they want to continue generating value from those demands. So it's not that value has gone away. The value is still there. There is a need to look at innovative measures to capture that value in a different manner. And I think any business, be it SME or be it startup or be it corporate, are now all on the same tangent wherein they need to restart or reimagine their businesses from the beginning, whether all the traditional philosophies are still working for them or they need to come up with new philosophies for the new world. So I think government can play a significant role in creating those awareness amongst the SME world where it is needed the most, which is in fact giving the highest employment in the country and is going to and would be playing, I think, the most critical role in reviving the economy.
Coming to Akshay, you heard everyone. Now, you know, we're talking about SMEs. SMEs are 70-80%, and I would include some of the startups also in that. Now, do you really see some of the startups in the next 60-90 days not being able to survive because of liquidity issues?
Absolutely. I think there will be a lot of startups who will actually go under in the next, maybe not 60 to 90 days, but probably maybe by the end of the year. And I think in some cases, like Ankit briefly mentioned, right, consumer behavior has changed. Right, a lot of so startups are like, I always classify two startups into criteria, right? It's the Indian Jugaad entrepreneur who always runs a very tight ship, who usually is able to overcome these tough times. And then you have like the capital fueled startups, right? When the Indian economy, the size of the population, the domestic consumption story has fascinated pretty much every startup in India for the last 3 years, right? And people have been growing at like unparalleled rates. Now, the problem is when you get the brakes put on that part of the economy, right? Whether it's in sectors like hospitality and tourism, which are very badly affected. So it's going to be the startups who are prudent, innovative, and not every startup is able to do that. I think you'll find a lot of startups will gain market leadership. They'll become much stronger than where they were 3 months, 6 months ago. And we're actually seeing examples of that even in our customer base, because we actually work with a lot of funded startups as well. And then you'll find startups which are just kind of like, you know, sitting on their heels, waiting for something to change. And I think the economy has gone through a shift. The consumer patterns have gone through a shift. Things probably will not go back to exactly the way they were in March, in February 2020. September 2020, things will be different. And I think you take this time where you don't have the pressure of consumers calling you, complaining about certain things, or, you know, hypergrowth that's been happening, to actually innovate on your business model and take it to the next level from here. And the startups that don't do that, I think, and I'm seeing plenty of examples out there, right, are either they're going to have to completely pivot. So for me, a shutdown includes a complete pivot, right? If you change your business model, go into a different industry and use the capital you have to figure out what's happening and what's the next wave of growth that's going to happen. So I think, and the government loans here, I think actually do help these startups as well. Just because a startup has raised funding doesn't mean that they can't go out into these MSME loans and actually get working capital to be able to work through these challenging times. So I think that's where it's going to help. But yeah, my honest, frank opinion would be that, yeah, we'll see a lot of startups shut down in the next 6 to 9 months.
All right. A lot of startups going down in the next few days, perhaps by the end of this year. Well, that's a very powerful thought. Adarsh, if I can come to you. In fact, Anurag, I would also want your input on this. If you remember, just a few days back, we had a similar show. We had a similar chat, and there was a gentleman by the name of Kuldeep Chaudhary. He said that, you know, he tried going to banks, and his friends also tried going to banks. They wanted to avail loans as per the stimulus package by the government, but most of them were not even entertained. And obviously, that does bring down a lot of people into thinking that enough is not being done. How do you react to that? How do you respond to that?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I think the first point I'll make here is that, you know, the government could do several things. And I just talk about broad buckets. I think we keep talking about stimulus package a lot. And I think what has been done. We can keep debating it endlessly. But really, what it will come down to beyond the stimulus package is how much of an enabling environment can the government create in the days to come? Because a lot of the startups and businesses were not created previously. And the consumers did not have demand because the government was doing any stimulus, right? It was the nature of human livelihood that demand exists in the country. The point I'm trying to make is, let's say a gentleman like Kuldeep Chaudhary and a lot of entrepreneurs, right? Ones who cannot avail business loans. You know, at one point you tell the banks to give loans to these businesses. The one businesses which are most desperate to take loans right now are stressed businesses. And we were talking about banks in the country having the highest NPA ratios. So what kind of incentives are they going to have to create more stressful assets on their books in the first case? And, you know, as I think Akshay mentioned earlier, I mean, you can give a loan all you want, but if the business does not kickstart, you don't have profits to repay those loans. So those loans only have short-term benefits. In the long term, really, it has to be the demand bounce back that carry businesses for a longer period of time. Which brings me to my second point, which is much more important in my opinion, which is an enabling environment, right? And what I mean by that is, if I talk specifically about travel, tourism, and hospitality, you look at the situation in the country today. Around 1 month, 45 days back, the government decided that it's going to go back to the structure where it will give authorities in the hands of states. Well, guess what? When you decentralize authority, you actually are pushing the country back into the license raj. I don't have a single law prevailing in the country now. So every state has different laws. So in many states, many districts have different laws. So I don't know whether my destiny is controlled by the prime minister or the cabinet of the country or by a subjudicial magistrate sitting next door. And it is completely back to the days of license raj. If you look at hotels in the country today, you can open hotels in, let's say, 13 to 15 states. Which have allowed hotels to open up. I don't understand the logic when you can open cinema, when you can open malls in these countries, when you have flights functioning in the country. Why are hotels not open in other states? And how are we not getting back to license raj if to enforce different SOPs for operationalizing hotels in different states? So, you know, for a traveler today, you know, forget a business. When we talk of demand, we are talking about an individual. Today, to figure out, can I get on a flight? How many days will I have to quarantine myself when I land in a particular city? Will I be allowed to check into a hotel? Are hotels operational or not? When I come back, how many days do I have to quarantine myself at home? Really, does the government expect that any kind of tourism can happen in this country? I mean, at this point of time? And you look at countries. Countries are already recovering. There are talk of travel bubbles between Australia and New Zealand. Thailand and China and what
Greece. Adarsh, let me just supplement my question over there as well. Do you think that the government is also stuck between a rock and a hard place? Because this is the first time, you know, even they have had to deal with something like this. So we have to give some for being, you know, caught off guard.
Yes, absolutely. And taking away from that, and I think we are completely supportive of the initial early proactive measures taken by the government. I think where the disconnect is, nobody was not supportive of the lockdown. We were completely supportive of the lockdown. And it was a right call. We still believe that. But how we unlock is going to be extremely critical in determining how long is it going to be a V-shaped recovery? Is it going to be a swish-shaped recovery? Or is it going to be an L-shaped recovery? Is going to be determined by the actions the government takes at this point of time.
So, you speak of unlock, you know, in fact, we are going in the opposite direction. Chennai locked right. up.
Yes.
Possibly we need to do that in Delhi. So, you know, Arash, I want to ask you two more questions. Our Prime Minister's dream has always been domestic tourism. Every Indian seeing, you know, new places in India. Do you think that will get a fillip in 3, 6, 12 months? Second, within your sector, do you see consolidation happening? Do you see players coming together? These are two things I'd like you to address.
Right, absolutely. I think I'll talk about the first question first. The potential exists in the market, right? I think we live in a country of 130 crore people, and net-net, we'll have a surplus if actually they don't open the international flights. People don't have the comfort to take international trips today. But they can definitely, there has to be, this is the time to push on Bharat Dekho campaign, right? You have to go, I think the Prime Minister had launched, not just the Atmanirbhar campaign, but also about like, you know, every Indian should have visited at least 15 destinations in the country. But for that, you need to build the traveler confidence. And now is the time to do that, right? Even if you want to open up the country in July or August or September, there has to be consistency of communication and guidelines across states.
And you're saying the states and the center have to be in tandem.
Absolutely.
That's the point.
You know,
so I would say each state has its own uniqueness. So I think at that, you know, states will take unique and independent calls. What about
it would be the best time to build up domestic tourism
in your sector?
Point of time. Yeah, and about consolidation, I think, see, we live in a very fragmented hotel industry. There are more than 80,000 hotel operators in the country, 2 million rooms, and less than 15% of this market is consolidated across brands, right? So I think this is not the time for consolidation. I think the kind of behavioral shifts that you're going to see, and logically so what we're already seeing, is that travelers will move from unbranded hotels to branded hotels. Because the fear in the minds of traveler is hygiene. The fear in the mind of traveler is consistency of experience. They need to know that what I see is what I'm going to get. And I think there's a great time for brands and hospitality to take fillip right now. I think even more than that, right? That was talking about the general traveler. I think when you talk about corporate travelers, what's going to happen is there's going to be a lot of pressure on costs. And so people are going to have down from 5 stars or 4 stars to 3 star or budget hotels. I think if you talk specifically about the segment that Fab Hotels operates in, we are very bullish from a 6 to 9 month perspective that given these two changes, consumer behaviors of unbranded to branded and from 5 stars and 4 stars to budget, we are well positioned to capture that market. However, we are very apprehensive of what kind of guidelines are going to come, how future unlocking is going to take place. And if you have constant and staggered lockdowns, even if you have talk about that or fear about that, that just puts back the traveler confidence by months, right? I think it's very important that the government is consistent in their approach and really what are going to be the trade-off between any further lockdowns versus the benefits to the economy or to the travelers or to the country in general. I think we don't want to fall behind. We're already behind the race in terms of so many growing countries like China and Vietnam and tourism with countries like Thailand and Sri Lanka and whatnot. That you just don't want to have any further disadvantages with yourself.
Thanks, Adarsh. Mrinal, you heard all your panelists. Adarsh just talked to you about consistency, you know, the opportunity. Tell us, how do you see the next 6, 9 months as an entrepreneur? I know beyond 9, 12 months, things will start coming back. But how do you, as an entrepreneur, how are you preparing yourself for, let's say, even a tougher 6 months?
I think for next 6 months, again, as I said before, we're going to concentrate on a takeaway. So even if, let's say, we are concentrating on a cappuccino takeaway more, so we are not looking at a brick and mortar for next 6 months that should be working for us. We're looking more at on terms of coffee carts being placed at safe zones where the consumer has more faith. Like even inside a hotel, once they start working. I mean, it's right. I mean, the consumer needs to have faith that, okay, it's safe to enter a hotel. Once that is also established, we will be looking at a coffee cart model for next 6 months to next 12 months. And even in areas where the consumer has more faith that they can move around, the malls are open, we would concentrate on takeaways and small shops where, of course, dine-in is not going to be the thing. And being in the coffee industry, I feel it will still be in demand because it's a lifestyle product. And creating according to what the consumer needs, that they will still be drinking coffee, whether at home or when they start stepping out. We'll be looking at not at a brick and mortar version, but at a coffee cart model mostly in the coming
months. You will also have to cultivate Atmanirbharta.
So when it comes to Atmanirbharta in our area, I mean, in our industry, I mean, we're not looking at funds per se in terms of getting from the government. But yes, we'll be cutting down on costs as much as we can without compromising on the quality of the product and being innovative as much as we can in terms of providing products like cold brew coffees, which are takeaway and can be had for 3 days. So when it comes to Atmanirbharta, it all comes down to being innovative in terms of product and services. And catering to what the consumer can afford and definitely needs today in terms of their demand of the product. That I would Mr. Dr. Anurag mentioned before that he has a concern about not having a Microsoft from our country. I think in terms of a healthy environment, we will have similar concerns in different industries as well. In the agriculture industry, that we don't have a startup that is leading globally. I mean, again, coming to the point that apart from when the concept of Atmanirbharta is in question, it's about self-reliance and how Gandhi pictures it in the long run. I would say the government has to step in to protect the Indian entrepreneurs, the Indian domestic companies to flourish so well that tomorrow we not only have a Microsoft in other industry, but also a leading global company in other sectors as well.
Now, I'll tell you why I said that. You take the auto sector. Now, saying that we will increase the duties on auto components from China, it will hurt the end consumer. The price that the end consumer buys the car will go up because, are dependent. What we have to do is create environment in the country where labor, land and capital become cheaper. I think that's what the government has to work towards, not in terms of tariffs. That's what I meant.
Another could be having stronger restrictions on FDI. And I mean, that's when the Atmanirbharta, that we can look at a country or the economy, which not only produces for its own citizen, but for a global market tomorrow. Sure. I mean, that would be Atmanirbharta in real sense, as according to me.
Aditya, to bring you in now, let's look at, if you talk to any entrepreneur, any industrialist, the only thing on their mind is liquidity, conserving cash, capital. True. Now tell us, the banks have been very conservative in the last 60 days. You see that credit coming to individuals and to companies getting better in the next 90 days or getting worse?
Mantu, if you're talking about entrepreneurs, not SMEs and MSMEs and all, you're talking startups, right? So, hello. So I think these guys were anyways more dependent on the angel investors or the clubs, hundreds of incubators and, startup clubs or the peer-to-peer lending kind of platforms. I don't see much happening there. Of course, angel investors are only going to get more serious and more conservative now because a lot of ground reality is going to change for a lot of startups. Credit thing, from bank side to the startups, I don't really see too many startups going to banks directly. They always, we've created a very nice ecosystem for startup in India now with so many players coming to it. And I believe that is going on very well. In fact, it's only going to get more serious and focused now. It was all a bhedshal so far who's raising how much and how much valuations and, who's getting what and all that. And I think now...
The focus is on raising money and valuations. Yeah. You're saying the focus will shift to being sustainable, going back to basics, spending money would generate revenue, putting money in performance marketing. Is that what you are saying?
Absolutely. So I speakers spoke about the Jugaad entrepreneur, and I think it's time for that. I've always believed that you know an entrepreneur should be self-funded for at least 2 to 3 years before he goes. Like so, in Gujarati, there's a saying that you know if your dhanda continues for 1,000 days, then it's good to go. Otherwise, you know not. So if you can survive for at least a year or so on your own, and you know grow it to a certain size, I mean. That is the way to go. I think we were going in a wrong way for a long, long time, thanks to the easy liquidity and easy availability of cash. I think we'll come back to some slightly conventional ways now. And I think this will be very interesting for serious entrepreneurs like me. So if I talk about myself, I've been bootstrapping for the last 7 years, successfully so. And every year thinking about taking on investors, but you know, then shying away. Because you know, when you're doing well, you don't want to grow 10 times, 20 times and then be answerable to investors who put in money and who are expecting now multiple returns. So I think you need serious entrepreneurs who are trying to build stuff, long-term stuff. And this situation is going to bring out, you know, separate wheat from the chaff. So credit, I do not see that as a problem. There is enough credit and government is, of course, going to put in more measures to ensure that credit is made available. But for the entrepreneurs and startups, there are enough clubs and private investors and family offices now available in the country over there.
Akshay, you know, again, coming back to, you know, liquidity, you know, everything is about consumer demand. It's about liquidity. It's having enough cash to last through the 3-6 months. Do you see that entrepreneurs will come out stronger or weaker? Because it's the change of mindset is the silver lining. The change of mindset from being funded to being sustainable. If that is the mindset change that has happened, what is the scenario you see 60 to 90 days from now?
Oh, absolutely. I think the startup ecosystem in general will come out much, much stronger because like Aditya said, right, it's about building fundamentally solid business models now. Because if your business could survive the last 90 days, it'll most likely be able to survive the next, hopefully, 9 years as well, right? Because, and that's assuming you were just not burning capital and you're waiting to burn out the rest of the capital in your bank. And I think this pandemic has really taught us about looking at unit economics, looking at profitability, looking at road to profitability. The questions that investors are asking today, right, are almost like a complete shift from what we were being asked a year later.
Give us a sense of that.
Absolutely, right? So for example, if we were asked a year ago, the first question on the table was, what is the size of the market? How deep is the market? How do you get to a unicorn level? Today, it's all about what happened in the last 90 days. Were you profitable? How much did you burn? And if you did not, if you did burn money, why?
And what is the cost of acquisition?
And,
right? And you know, bringing that down.
I think what's happened is a lot of the froth has gone away, right? And I think Ankit was mentioning this briefly earlier, is a lot of the people who were bidding, for example, on the digital media, on performance marketing, right? They were bidding 2-3x and were taking years to break even on their customers. A lot of that froth has gotten away. Because with the lockdown, do you really want to acquire customers who may not be able to spend money for the next 60, 90 days? So I think what's happened is fundamentally sound businesses who are not able to justify spending that kind of money are now being able to scale up much quicker. And I think the other big thing that's happening is, which is helping startups, especially in the tech space like ours, is that, and we spoke about this briefly before the show, is the digitalization, right? Every entrepreneur that I know who was working with our platform and was only offline has been telling me that they want to go online for the last 1 year. And almost, I would say, less than 10% of them actually made that transition. Why? The offline business is doing well, everything was going great guns. It was just a question of, you know, inertia. And in the last 60 days, these same entrepreneurs have set up their online websites, are figuring out, I'm getting calls morning to evening. How do I make this bigger and bigger?
But the government wanted this, and unintentionally so, because of COVID-19, you know, what they wanted actually fructified.
Absolutely. And again, it's unfortunate the way it's happened, but I think this is why I believe the structural pattern of the economy is going to shift once we come out of this pandemic. There's a lot of noise right now. There's obviously a lag in demand. People are not buying as much. But once all of that ends 6-9 months from now, you'll find online being a much bigger medium, digital payments being much, much bigger than what they were before, cash on delivery becoming less. So in the long term, I think startups in the tech ecosystem especially, and even in the product ecosystem, are going to be much, much stronger.
You remind me of a song, "What doesn't kill you makes you stronger." So if the startups survive the next 90 days, they possibly, on a real way, will be stronger, healthier, and hopefully will build something valuable. Ankit, the conversation from all panelists revolved around technology. Now, if you had to predict 36 months from now, you know, where will be the digital economy of India? Where will we be if, you know, suppose, and let me give you some parameter. Today, e-commerce is a small size of, you know, the overall purchase cycle. So if it is less than 8% right now, will it be at 50%, 60%, 70%? Where would it be?
Great question. Well, we do, all of us agree that digital economy is going to boost. It is definitely, I mean, we see the change in consumer behavior and people, even, you know, doing physical operations now wanting to come digital, and they are now more forced to do it. But having such expectations, which is jumping from 8% to 50-60%, might not be a fair expectation to the people who are working in the digital economy, because although yes, the behavior is changing, but if you look at how it is trickling down the pyramid, the change itself is, the rate of change is going down as we go down in the pyramid, right? So,
but access will be cheaper. They will have devices, people in rural India, semi-India. So the digital divide may go away, whether you call it the geo effect or whatever. And there may be the pipe and the devices to do that e-commerce. If we assume that, do you think then a 50-60% number is fair to expect?
I mean, on an average, you know, Y Combinator says if a startup is growing by 25% month on month, then they are doing really great. So I believe if we consider that as a benchmark, and if our industry is growing 25% month on month, I would consider it as a great achievement. During this tough times, we learned something and we were able to execute on it, and we were able to grow. Even if we grow 25% month on month, that would be great. But having said that, you know, as an entrepreneur, we always see toughest times as the biggest opportunities. And therefore, you know, we see, you know, the kind of problems that we see surrounding us are all the billion-dollar opportunities surrounding us. And it's a great time to become an entrepreneur for fresh startups who wish to come up and pursue entrepreneurship. I think it's a great time. And this is also a great time to strengthen the government startup partnerships. You know,
how?
Yeah, I'll give you an example. I think, you know, if somebody is running a hotel chain and because of lockdown, that infrastructure is getting unused or it's in surplus, can we utilize it for something else? Because that infrastructure is still there, that asset is still there, but it is going unutilized. And government is sitting at the right position to be aware of what is how much of the infrastructure is getting used in which industry and how much is not, and how can we connect the dots and create a very carefully planned execution which can optimally utilize all the existing infrastructure and can help other industries grow. I think you know, government startup partnership is required, because when it comes to careful planning and a fast execution, it's a great combo to have. Government is always careful.
Yes. We only have 3 minutes left into the show, and you know, it's customary for me and Anurag usually to spend the last few minutes in getting your opinion and your suggestions as to where will the economy be or should be in the next 60 to 90 days. Let me start with Adarsh.
Yeah, Vineet, I think if I had to sum up, I would say that, you know, we really have to run a sprint. We have to run a marathon at a sprintly pace to get to where we were before COVID. Shoot ourselves in the foot. Let's have guidelines that can be consistent and that reimpose confidence in travelers and consumers to start moving around again.
short answer, Adarsh. Will the Indian better in 90 days or it will be worse than it is now?
It has to get better in 90 days. We all have to get together and make it happen. It's definitely not going to happen.
Too idealistic, right? Will it?
Mrinal?
I think if we are able to have proper medical services and we're able to save people, then yes, we'll be able to survive.
And if not, then we will be worse off. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, I mean, then we can look at a further lockdown.
Aditya, we live in Bombay. We're doing this show from Bombay. Bombay is looking really serious.
Yeah.
So Where will be the Indian economy 90 days from now?
Will be definitely better only and only if states, center and the bureaucracy, they all work in tandem. Else,
That's an idealistic scenario. I'm asking you a realistic scenario and an honest assessment of where the Indian economy will be.
I don't think much will change. I don't think much will change in 90 days. I believe for the economy, not much will change in 90 days, but things can get better on the ground if all these three pillars are working in tandem. That's all.
Ankit?
Yes, I am very optimistic and I see that we would be able to revive our economy in 90 days simply because हम इंडियंस के अंदर ना एक जुगाड़ एक 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 ऐसी ताकत है जिसको शायद कोई इट्स एन अनमैचेबल सुपर पावर दैट वी हैव
रेजिलियंस एंड द फ्रूगल रेजिलियंस एंड फ्रूगल इनोवेशन
यस
वी कैन बी
रिसोर्सफुलनेस द रिसोर्सफुलनेस द इंडिजिनस रिसोर्सफुलनेस व्हिच इज जुगाड़ व्हिच इज देयर इनसाइड ईच वन ऑफ अस वी आर गोइंग टू फिगर इट आउट and we'll make sure that the economy revives in the next 90 days.
That's Atmanirbharta according to you. Relying on our Jugadpanti and our resourcefulness, right?
Yeah, I believe right from the bottom layer to top layer, everybody is going to work on themselves, create something innovative and make sure that we...
Akshay, last word from you and then we wrap up.
I personally think we'll be better off. I think we're learning from our mistakes. We've made lots of them in the last 3 months. And continue learning, which I think we're doing, we'll all be better off 90 days from now.
Winnie, I normally don't give my view, but I'll give you a 20-second view. In my view, it's a health issue, healthcare issue. As long as Mrinal said, we are able to tackle that healthcare issue with more testing, with more beds, and give people the confidence to go back to their businesses and to give them the confidence to spend money, the economy will be better. If we as a society are not able to provide that assurance, then we'll be worse off.
All right, so basically you just synopsized a very old adage that health is perhaps the only wealth. And if we take care of the wealth will take care of itself. All right, on that note, we're going to wrap up. Thank you, everyone, for being here, being part of this extremely delightful and articulate show. Thank you.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.